In this video, we're looking at the physics behind how a siphon works. So what we're looking at here is a container full of water, and I've put a tube in it, and the tube, and this is critically important, is also full of water at the beginning of this process. So right now, let's say I have my thumb over the end. Another important point here is this end that I'm covering with my thumb right now is below the surface level of the water. Otherwise, this isn't going to work. So I'm going to examine two interesting points. One right there below point A, and that's at the exact same height as the surface of the water, but it's inside the tube. Because the surface of the water has a pressure of 1 atmosphere, simply because it's exposed to the atmosphere, and this point inside the tube is at the same height in a connected fluid, it's also going to have a pressure of 1 atmosphere. Now let's look at the instant that I take my thumb off of the tube. So nothing's moving yet, and suddenly the pressure is 1 atmosphere. At the end of the tube because I just exposed that water to the atmosphere. Now we can start to get into some physics. So if I look at the left-hand side, I'm going to take the lowest point, that's P atmospheric, and say that that's equal to the pressure above it at PA plus a rho G HA, the increase in depth in the fluid. And this means that PA is atmospheric pressure minus rho g h a. We then do the same calculation on the right hand side of the tube. My lowest point is P atmospheric. This means that at point B the pressure is less than atmospheric. There's no problem with that. And so I think of B as my starting point, and then I say the pressure increases on my way down to the bottom, which is P atmospheric. And we find that PB is equal to P atmospheric minus rho G H B. So then given that HB is bigger than HA, again, this is just saying mathematically that the end of this tube is below the surface level of the water. That means that PA has had a smaller number subtracted from atmospheric than PB did, so PA must be bigger. So then to complete the argument on sort of determining what's going to happen here, I like to look at a little horizontal column of water up there and say, okay, the left end of this thing feels the pressure PA. And of course, that pressure exerts a force, and the force is given by pressure times area. So I'll call that FA, and that's equal to PA times whatever the cross-sectional area is for that thing. There's still a pressure at point B, and that's going to exert a force given by the pressure on that side multiplied by whatever the cross-sectional area is for the tube. And then I'll say if all I'm doing is multiplying the pressure by the same area in order to find the force, then clearly the force exerted at A is going to be bigger than the force exerted at B. This means there's a net force to the right on that little chunk of water. So we can say with certainty that the water begins accelerating this way, and we end up with water flowing spontaneously out of this container, provided we still keep the end of the tube below the surface of the water. So there you have it. That's the physics behind how a siphon works.